Welcome to Sandy Springs United Methodist Church on this rainy day. As Joyce Donaldson said to me in Sunday school today, she said, every day is a beautiful day when we're here. So I'm taking that to heart. We're so glad that you are here on this beautiful day to worship God together. My name is Kate Floyd, and I am the pastor here. We extend a special welcome to those of you who may be visiting with us for the first time or watching online for the first time. We hope this community feels like home to you. There are several ways to let us know that you are here, and if you'd like more information about our church community, you'll find in the pew back in front of you, we have these connect cards. You can fill out the information there and place it in the offering plate. We also have an online connect card that's on our website and on a QR code on the front of your bulletin. Friends, we kicked off our fall celebration last Sunday, and there is a lot happening in the life of the church. So I really do encourage you to take your announcements home from your bulletin, go to our website, read your emails for all that's going on. But a few things to point to your attention today. As I mentioned, we did start adult Sunday school class back today. They gather in the fellowship hall, a joint class at 9:45, and the lesson starts at 10. Our intern, Sarah Cook, is teaching that, and we'd love to have you join each week. 2 weeks from today, Sunday, October 3rd, we are celebrating that Willie Wise has been on staff here for 30 years. So we're going to have a big celebration after worship. So we hope that you will stay that Sunday, spread the word, invite others, and celebrate Willie and Cheryl and all the gifts that they have given over the years to this church community. Those are our announcements, friends. But as always, it is our great privilege to worship God together. So as we do so, know that whoever you are, wherever you may find yourself on your faith journey, you are God's beloved child, and you are welcome. Today is the second week in our worship series called Faith Flow, Growing as Disciples, where we are exploring the different characteristics of what it means to be a disciple, a follower of Jesus Christ, and how we can help one another on that journey. Today, our theme is connection. How do we, as fellow church members, as disciples, connect more deeply to one another through God and Jesus Christ? And we're going to hear Paul's words to the community in Corinth as a foundation. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of the one Spirit. He goes on to write, when one suffers, we all suffer. When one rejoices, we all rejoice. What a model for us today as the church. I invite you to rise now as you're able and join me in saying our call to worship. We have gathered together to rejoice in our oneness in Jesus Christ. Each of us experiences faith and life in a unique way. Yet we have one God, one faith, and one baptism, and one Spirit who unites us all. Let us lift our hearts as one in songs of praise and prayer and in listening for God's word. Even when we leave this place, let us be joined in common concern for humanity, like that shown by Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning, friends. It is great to see you today on this rainy day. It brightens the day to be in this body of Christ together with you in this place. So a question for you as we get to look around, glad to have you here. If we can imagine what it would be like if instead of seeing each other as we are now, if we looked was just a big mouth.
No!
Kai especially says no. I imagine you think I'd be giving you lots of rules and directions all the time. Everybody out there, thumbs up, thumbs down. Oh, Zara in the back giving very emphatic thumbs down. Oh, thanks, buddy. So sweet. Always throwing out some compliments. Daisy also giving a thumbs down. Oh, Charles, thumbs down. Thanks. Okay, no, no. All right, let's try one more. What if I was just cute little baby feet? Come on! How cute are these? Instead of a face, I just have baby feet sticking out of my neck. What do we think? Thumbs up or thumbs down? No, no. Even in the balcony, I'm seeing thumbs down. No, no. No, even a thumbs down for the baby feet. All right. In the middle, because baby feet are really cute, right? You just want to gobble them up. Then people might try to gobble my head up. That would be really weird. Okay. No to the baby feet instead of a face. Okay. So we're agreed. We don't want to replace my head with just one big thing. In fact, we're going to hear that today in our scripture. We can't be just one thing, can we? We need all different kinds of things. Our bodies need to have all different kinds of parts. Like if we were just hands, how would we get anywhere? We wouldn't know where we're going. If we were just ears, how would we be able to sing? If we were just feet, how would we be able to eat? You can't eat with your toes, can you? No.
If
we were just a mouth, we wouldn't be able to do anything, right? We need all the different parts of us. And the same thing is true of the body of Christ, right? Stay with me, Kai. We need all the different parts of the body of Christ, all the different people who make up the body of Christ, and all the different gifts that we have, which we're going to head upstairs and talk about in Children's Church. No, we're not. We're going to sing a song together in Children's Church in just a minute. We're not going to sing right now, but I love that you want to share that gift. We need people who like to sing and people who like to dance, people who have gifts of painting, people who have gifts of speaking, and people who have gifts of listening, all together to make up the body of Christ. I hear you. We'll sing it in a little bit. But first, we're going to pass on the peace of Christ to this amazing, diverse body of Christ, knowing that we all have gifts to share with one another. So we raise our hands attached to all the other parts of us together, and our younger parts of the body of Christ will say, may the peace of Christ be with you, and our older parts of the body of Christ will respond, and also with you. Ready? May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Any friends who are coming to Children's Church can meet us in the narthex in just a moment. Thank you.
You may be seated. A service celebrating his life will be held here in the sanctuary this Saturday, September 25th at 3 p.m. If you have prayer requests that you would like to share with this community, joys or needs or concerns, we have prayer request cards you can find in the pew back in front of you. We also have a prayer request link online. We have a prayer team that gathers every Thursday morning that will be praying for and with you. If you prefer it to remain confidential for my eyes only, you can mark that as well and place it in the offering plate. Let us pray. Loving and gracious God, we come to you today with a spirit of thanksgiving for the good news that we are indeed one body of Christ in you. Thank you for the gift of baptism, of diversity within our own giftedness, and the way you make a place for us in your family. Continue to connect us with you through the body of Christ in this community and to the church universal. Help us connect with each other, loving our neighbor as ourselves, and reaching out in connection to our neighbors near and far. We know, God, that when one suffers, we all suffer. So today we lift up to you all who are experiencing pain, grief, illness, violence, loss of any kind. We pray for those experiencing oppression, isolation, and injustice in all its forms. We know that your healing hands, your unconditional love, and your spirit of redemption comes into our broken world with peace and grace, forgiveness and mercy, new and abundant life through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So too, God, we also rejoice with those who rejoice, lifting up with gratitude all the places where your light shines and new life breaks. We pray all of this in the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to rise as you're able. As we sing together our hymn for the day, you'll know we are Christians by our love. The words are on the insert in your bulletin.
Thank you.
word of God. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But as it is, God arranged the members of the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable, and those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with greater honor, and our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has so arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there may be no dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care for one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Praise be to God. Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. When I was 7 years old, my family moved from Athens, Georgia to Lubbock, Texas. We are a good Methodist family, and so pretty quickly we started visiting churches to figure out what would be our new church home in this new place. One Sunday, we visited St. John's United Methodist Church. It was right across the street from Texas Tech University, where my parents worked. Now my father, who's here, I don't know if they would be here, I'm talking about him today, has Methodism in his DNA. In fact, his middle name is Wesley, after John Wesley, the founder of Methodism. He's got father, grandfather, great-uncle, who are all Methodist clergy. My mother, on the other hand, grew up Presbyterian. She acquiesced, though, when they married, because there really was no fighting that strong Methodist DNA, so she came over to the right side, and we're a Methodist family. Still, though, I will say you can take the Presbyterian out of a bagpipe-laced service, but you can't always take the frozen chosenness out of a Presbyterian. So while they liked many things about that first worship service at St. John's UMC, people were very warm and friendly. There was a magnificent music program and organ. There were meaningful spiritual formation opportunities for all ages. There was one real hang-up that my mom had. You see, each week during the worship service, they passed the microphone around the sanctuary, and anybody present could stand up and offer a joy or a concern that had happened that week. Now, it's not like they were speaking in tongues or, God forbid, clapping along with the music, but she could not believe that they just let that mic pass around and let people speak as the Spirit moved without any plan. And sometimes, as a newcomer, it can feel a little bit off-putting because you don't know the people and what they're saying. Maybe it made you feel a little left out or like an outsider. But my mom did get over the informality of the mic being passed with unplanned speaking. We all began to soften towards it. It was the church that we joined and made our church home that really became a second home to me as I was growing up. And for all of us over time, that joys and concerns part of the worship service really became one of our favorite pieces of what it meant to gather together in community and to worship. Because each week, people we knew and loved, or maybe didn't know so well, or were meeting for the first time, were vulnerable. They shared what was important to them, and all of us were able to hold it together before each other and before God. It was set aside sacred time and space to honor what everybody was experiencing in community. So when I hear this text from 1 Corinthians that Amy just read, a very familiar one where Paul describes the church as the body of Christ, that we are members of one another, that when one suffers, we all suffer. When one celebrates, we all celebrate. I am taken right back to that sanctuary at St. John's. That place where people would stand up and say, "This is the first anniversary of my wife's death, and I covet your prayers." And my niece just got a cancer diagnosis, and I told her that this community would be lifting her up in prayer. Thank you for praying for my job search, although I've been unemployed for a long time, and I just want to give thanks that I have a new job and I'm starting on Monday. Sometimes a child would timidly raise his or her hand and say, "Guess what? I got an A on my spelling test. Thanks for your prayers." Now, we are also human, as all Christians are, and sometimes this practice could get a bit messy, go on for a long time. There was Carl, who was always a fixture at the church, and he got into a pattern about once a month of standing up and saying, "I just want to give thanks to God that I've quit smoking. It's been 2 weeks. Thank you for supporting me on that journey." And then inevitably, he would leave church early and go in the church bathroom and smoke. The pastor had to find me. I would come to Jesus with him and say, you just can't tell us that every single week. It could also sometimes be a way for people to get announcements in that weren't actually prayer requests. Like, "Oh, I just want to give thanks that my son Brandon has found the Boy Scouts, and I just thank you, God, for the good business skills that they're teaching them. In fact, he actually has his popcorn sign-up sheet with him today, so if you want to buy that, just find us after church, and we'll be happy to make the sale." So we have the joys and concerns every single week, meaningful, humorous, revealing all of our humanity. But also in addition to that, once a month, there was a service where you could come forward and receive a blessing at the altar rail. So there'd be a time when you would come forward, you would kneel, the pastor would come by and say, what would you like a blessing for today? He would put his hand on you and say to the whole congregation through the microphone, "We give thanks that Kate celebrates her birthday this week and ask your blessing on this next year." My brother and I have the same birthday 4 years apart, so every year we look forward to when we could go up together and receive that blessing in community. When we celebrated, our community celebrated with us. When we suffered or mourned, our community suffered and mourned alongside us. These rituals helped me feel like I belonged as a young person to God, to this church community, and that my sufferings and celebrations mattered to the body of Christ, and that the sufferings and celebrations of my fellow church members matter to Christ and should matter to me. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. From the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Last week, we introduced our new faith flow system. If you were here, you got this card. And it shows us where we are on our journey of discipleship, how we can grow in our faith in Jesus Christ, and how we can support one another in doing that as a church community. If you weren't here last week and you didn't get this card, we have more in the narthex you can take. All of this is also online under Faith Flow. But each week we're taking a deep dive into one of the characteristics of what it means to be a disciple. There are 6 characteristics we've named: worship, connect, grow, serve, share, and give. A vital aspect of being a disciple of Jesus Christ is that we connect deeply with each other on a real soul level. that we become a place of vulnerability and support and care, of growth and accountability, of grace and forgiveness and unconditional love, where we say to each other, how is it with your soul? And we mean it, and we listen deeply, and we make space for each other. Glennon Doyle, who's a writer and a speaker, she's a Presbyterian, in fact. She is also a recovering alcoholic. And she talks powerfully about what happens in AA meetings, Alcoholics Anonymous meetings, the truth-telling, the sheer vulnerability, the honesty of laying everything out before each other, the good, the bad, and the ugly that's part of that process, and then finding acceptance and accountability in the midst of that confession. And as you know, many AA meetings happen in church basements. And Doyle says that it's a shame that she finds more often than not there can be more honesty and truth-telling with one another in church basements than there is in church sanctuaries, where we put on our finest clothes, maybe we disguise our puppy eyes with makeup, and when people ask us how we are, even and especially if it's not true, we say, oh, I'm doing well, thanks for asking. One of her missions in being a writer and a Christian is to change that, to share vulnerably what's going on, to say this should be a place where we can really be honest with each other. I'm new here at Sandy Springs, UMC. You know that you don't need me to stand up here and tell you what it means to connect with each other as a church community and love, or how to do it. When I first started a little over 2 years ago, some of you may remember that we had a series of what we called cottage meetings. In some ways it seems like a lifetime ago, but it was 2 years ago. And I gathered with groups of you, 8, 10, 12 people, and folks went around the room and we shared names and introductions, but also, what do you love most about this church? How did you get here? What are your hopes and your dreams? And let me tell you, overwhelmingly, what folks said about why they love this church is the way that people connect with each other, reach out and love with one another. Will Kiner said that in Sunday school this morning, right? That's what's missed the most, is just sitting around tables, sharing stories, saying, how has it been with your week? That was overwhelmingly the answer from those of you here, and I have witnessed that powerfully over the last 2 years. I've seen it in action. We have just hired a new staff member, Brittany Morgan, whose title will be the Director of Community Connection. She starts on Tuesday, so we cover your prayers. When she was in her interview process, in her final interview, she asked those of us who were sitting around the table, what is your dream for this position? How can it help the church over the next 5 years? It was a great question. And Candace Johnson, our director of family ministry, said, with tears in her eyes, which won't surprise you if you know Candace, but she said with tears in her eyes, she said, I see the way that people in this church who've been here 15, 20, 40, 50 years care so deeply and intimately for each other, how the relationships go deep and wide, where they are for the birth of each other's children and then grandchildren, through relationships that were new, maybe struggles along the way, caring for aging parents and illnesses. And she said, now to watch these relationships and these groups that have been together for so long continue to support one another when one of those spouses dies, or a child has an illness, are present for each other's ups and downs. And Candace said, my dream for connection is that people who are newer to the church, that are younger generations, that people who now have young children or youth, or navigating young adulthood or single life or relationship struggles, can form those same kind of bonds that go deep. And that those bonds begin to last through decades, so that no matter what life throws their way, they know that I have got a community here that knows me, that loves me, and will carry me through. We are in the process of preparing for our church council's annual strategic planning retreat, where we set goals for the next year, do some evaluation. And we met with the man who will be facilitating the retreat, and we were talking about questions that all churches are asking in a COVID world, sadly not a post-COVID world yet, one that continues, and how every church is responding differently now to the needs that are before us, that those needs look different than they did 2 years ago. And he said, which is no surprise to us, right, one of the great needs that we have in the world that was true before the pandemic, but that the pandemic has really put into stark relief, is that people are lonely, are seeking deep kind of soul connection, are struggling with mental illness, want to be rooted in a community where they can be themselves and know other people and grow. And so Lisa and I were meeting with him and we said, listen, that is a gift that our community has that we have heard named over and over again and that we have seen. What a gift that is part of this church's DNA, and that is what our world and our community need right now. So I think one of the big questions before us is, how do we leverage this gift? How do we share it more widely with newcomers, with people who haven't been here as long, with our neighbors that we don't yet know? We're excited that Brittany's coming on staff to help lead teams of laity to deepen the connection both internally and externally, fostering connection among our members, helping connect visitors and newcomers more deeply into the life of the church. One of her primary goals will be to create some systems where we welcome new people here, have adequate follow-up connection between folks who may be new and have been here a long time, and help people move through this discipleship system so we all grow together. Because friends, we have so much to offer. A connection to a community that offers the good news of Jesus Christ, not just in word and in worship, but manifested in the ways that we reach out to one another. We can model this for the world that needs it, that showing up for and with each other. And none of this means that we are a community that's perfect or that is unified in all things. I was at a gathering on Thursday with our bishop and our district superintendent and some other clergy, and she in fact read from 1 Corinthians, a different part of the book. But she said Paul was writing to communities, church communities that had some conflict and trying to help them remember how to be in relationship with one another and move forward. And our bishop said, look, without church conflict, there would be no New Testament. So she said, it's been there from the beginning. It's who we are. It's where we are. But keeping our eyes on the mind of Christ keeps us unified in all things. A church is imperfect. John Wesley said, though we may not think alike, may we not love alike. This is what Jesus embodies, what he calls us to embody. And what Paul, writing to that community in Corinth, knew, as we know all these years later, that what we do share at the heart of who we are is one shared baptism in Jesus Christ. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. And each one of us, friends, each one of us, in our diverse God-given gifts, Paul tells us, has a vital role to play in community. We are all needed. We all need each other. So let us reach out. Let us reach out to one another, to our neighbors, to our community with that great gift of connection, so that the world may know that through Jesus Christ, the members of the body may have the same care of one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. May it be so, friends, on earth as it is in heaven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Christians by our love, yes, in love.
tie into our faith flow, to our vision, and our history of being a wellspring. We're going to do an art installation so you can see over time how your words and thoughts and prayers get collected together. Last week we asked you what brings you closest to God in worship, and we wrote that on here. This week your prompt that's in your bulletin is, how can I connect with one person from the church this week? So I invite you to think and pray about that, and as you leave today in the narthex, you'll see these water drops with markers. You can write that there and place it in the basket, and we'll add it to our art installation. As a response to our scripture, the word of God, the good news of Jesus Christ, we affirm our faith together. So I invite you now, as you're able to stand, and join me in saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
As we come to our time of offering, we thank you for your generosity. Your bulletin includes information on many ways that you can give at this time. Know that your giving makes an impact. For example, your giving helps support our blessing of the animal service that's next Sunday. This is an opportunity for us to come together in worship and Julie to reach out and invite our community and neighbors who care about their animals and make an impact for Angels Among Us Pet Rescue. Thank you. Please join me in a time of prayer over our offerings. Holy God, what a privilege it is to be on a journey of discipleship. Thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who gifts us with life and life abundant. During this time, may we give generously as a response to your faithfulness, and may you bless these gifts that we are about to receive for your service, so that we can continue to make disciples of Jesus Christ. In your holy name, amen.
Thank you.
today for worship. We're so glad that you are here. One of the ways that we are connecting in community this fall is on Wednesday nights for refuel. We have dinner outside from 5 to 6 p.m., which is a great time of visiting and getting to know one another. And then we have spiritual formation opportunities for all ages from 6 to 7 before choir rehearsals at 7:15. If you'd like to join us this Wednesday for a meal, we do need you to sign up so we can order the right number. You can do that online or by calling the church office, but we also have a physical sign-in sheet right in the back here, so you can write your name down and let us know that you will be with us. As Amy said, our offering next Sunday is our first ever blessing of the animal service at 4 p.m. on the front lawn. So we hope that you will bring your furry and feathered, maybe, friends. If you would like to bring a picture of a cat or an animal that's not really appropriate to bring, you can do that. You can bless the picture. My children, much to their chagrin, do not have a pet in the home, but they're excited to be around other animals or are going to bring their stuffed animals to bless. So everybody is welcome. Spread the word. We hope that you'll be there and invite your animal-loving friends. As we go today, though, I invite you to join me in saying our benediction, which is found in your bulletin. For all that God can do within us, for all that God can do without us, thanks be to God. For all in whom Christ lived before us, for all in whom Christ lives beside us, thanks be to God. For all the Spirit wants to bring us, for where the Spirit wants to lead us, thanks be to God. Listen, Christ has promised to be with us in the world as in our worship. We go to serve him. Amen.